Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beauty, a Very Short Introduction, by Roger Scruton. Narrated by Chris MacDonnell. Preface. Beauty can be consoling, disturbing, sacred, profane. It can be exhilarating, appealing, inspiring, chilling. It can affect us in an unlimited variety of ways. Yet it is never viewed with indifference. Beauty demands to be noticed. It speaks to us directly, like the voice of an intimate friend. If there are people who are indifferent to beauty, then it is surely because they do not perceive it. Yet judgments of beauty concern matters of taste, and maybe taste has no rational foundation. If so, how do we explain the exalted place of beauty in our lives? And why should we lament the fact, if fact it is, that beauty is vanishing from our world? And is it the case, as so many writers and artists have suggested since Baudelaire and Nietzsche, that beauty and goodness may diverge, so that a thing can be beautiful precisely in respect of its immorality? Moreover, since it is in the nature of tastes to differ, how can a standard erected by one person's taste be used to cast judgment on another's? How, for example, can we pretend that one type of music is superior or inferior to another when comparative judgments merely reflect the taste of the one who makes them? That familiar relativism has led some people to dismiss judgments of beauty as purely subjective. No tastes can be criticized, they argue, since to criticize one taste is simply to give voice to another. Hence, there is nothing to learn or to teach that could conceivably deserve the name of criticism. This attitude has put in question many of the traditional disciplines in the humanities. The studies of art, music, literature, and architecture, freed from the discipline of aesthetic judgment, seem to lack the firm anchor in tradition and technique that enabled our predecessors to regard them as central to the curriculum. Hence the current crisis in the humanities. Is there any point in studying our artistic and cultural inheritance when the judgment of its beauty has no rational grounds? Or if we do study it, should this not be in a skeptical spirit by way of questioning its claims to objective authority and deconstructing its posture of transcendence? When each year the Turner Prize, founded in memory of England's greatest painter, is awarded to yet another bundle of facetious ephemera, is this not proof that there are no standards, that fashion alone dictates who will and will not be rewarded, and that it is pointless to look for objective principles of taste or a public conception of the beautiful? Many people answer yes to these questions, and as a result, renounce the attempt to criticize either the taste or the motives of the Turner Prize judges. In this book, I suggest that such skeptical thoughts about beauty are unjustified. Beauty, I argue, is a real and universal value, one anchored in our rational nature, and the sense of beauty has an indispensable part to play in shaping the human world. My approach to the topic is not historical, neither am I concerned to give a psychological, still less an evolutionary, explanation of the sense of beauty. My approach is philosophical, and the principal sources for my argument are the works of philosophers. The point of this book is the argument which it develops, which is designed to introduce a philosophical question and to encourage you, the reader, to answer it. Some parts of this book started life elsewhere, and I am grateful to the editors of the British Journal of Aesthetics, the Times Literary Supplement, Philosophy, and City Journal for permission to rework material that has already appeared in their pages. I am also grateful to Christian Brugger, Malcolm Budd, Bob Grant, John Hyman, Anthony O'Hare, and David Wiggins for helpful comments on previous drafts. They saved me from many errors, and I apologize for the errors that remain, which are all my fault. R.S. Sperryville, Virginia, May 2008. Chapter 1. Judging Beauty. We discern beauty in concrete objects and abstract ideas, in works of nature and works of art, in things, animals and people, in objects, qualities and actions. As the list expands to take in just about every ontological category, there are beautiful propositions as well as beautiful words, beautiful proofs as well as beautiful snails, even beautiful diseases and beautiful deaths. It becomes obvious that we are not describing a property like shape, size or color, uncontroversially present to all who can find their way around the physical world. For one thing, how could there be a single property exhibited by so many disparate types of thing? Well, why not? After all, we describe songs, landscapes, moods, scents and souls as blue. Does this not illustrate the way in which a single property can occur under many categories? No, is the answer. For while there is a sense in which all those things can be blue, they cannot be blue in the way that my coat is blue. In referring to so many types of thing as blue, we are using a metaphor, one that requires a leap of the imagination if it is to be rightly understood. Metaphors make connections which are not contained in the fabric of reality, but created by our own associative powers. The important question about a metaphor is not what property it stands for, but what experience it suggests. But in none of its normal uses is beautiful a metaphor, even if, like many a metaphor, it ranges over indefinitely many categories of object. So, why do we call things beautiful? What point are we making, and what state of mind does our judgment express? The true, the good, and the beautiful. There is an appealing idea about beauty which goes back to Plato and Plotinus, and which became incorporated by various routes into Christian theological thinking. According to this idea, beauty is an ultimate value, something that we pursue for its own sake, and for the pursuit of which no further reason need be given. Beauty should therefore be compared to truth and goodness, one member of a trio of ultimate values which justify our rational inclinations. Why believe P? Because it is true. Why want X? Because it is good. Why look at Y? Because it is beautiful. In some ways, philosophers have argued, those answers are on a par. Each brings a state of mind into the ambit of reason by connecting it to something that is in our nature as rational beings to pursue. Someone who asked, why believe what is true, or why want what is good, has failed to understand the nature of reasoning. He doesn't see that if we are to justify our beliefs and desires at all, then our reasons must be anchored in the true and the good. Does the same go for beauty? If someone asks me, why are you interested in X? Is because it is beautiful a final answer, one that is immune to counter-argument, like the answers, because it is good and because it is true? To say as much is to overlook the subversive nature of beauty. Someone charmed by a myth may be tempted to believe it, and in this case, beauty is the enemy of truth. See Pindar. Beauty which gives the myth's acceptance renders the incredible credible. First Olympian Ode. A man attracted to a woman may be tempted to condone her vices, and in this case, beauty is the enemy of goodness. See L'Abbé Prévost, Manon Lescaut, which describes the moral ruin of the Chevalier de Grayot by the beautiful Manon. Goodness and truth never compete, we assume, and the pursuit of the one is always compatible with a proper respect for the other. The pursuit of beauty, however, is far more questionable. From Kierkegaard to Wilde, the aesthetic way of life, in which beauty is pursued as the supreme value, has been opposed to the life of virtue. The love of myths, stories, and rituals, the need for consolation and harmony, the deep desire for order, all have drawn people to religious beliefs, regardless of whether those beliefs are true. The prose of Flaubert, the imagery of Baudelaire, the harmonies of Wagner, the sensuous forms of Canova, have all been accused of immorality by those who believe that they paint wickedness in alluring colours. We don't have to agree with such judgments in order to acknowledge their point. The status of beauty as an ultimate value is questionable in the way that the status of truth and goodness are not. Let us at least say that this particular path to the understanding of beauty is not easily available to a modern thinker. The confidence with which philosophers once trod it is due to an assumption made explicit already in the Enneads of Plotinus that truth, beauty, and goodness are attributes of the deity, ways in which the divine unity makes itself known to the human soul. That theological vision was edited for Christian use by St. Thomas Aquinas and embedded in the subtle and comprehensive reasoning for which that philosopher is justly famous. But it is not a vision that we can assume, and I propose for the time being to set it to one side, considering the concept of beauty without making any theological claims. Aquinas's own view of the matter is worth noting, however, since it touches on a deep difficulty in the philosophy of beauty. Aquinas regarded truth, goodness, and unity as transcendentals, features of reality possessed by all things, since they are aspects of being, ways in which the supreme gift of being is made manifest to the understanding. His views on beauty are more implied than stated. Nevertheless, he wrote as though beauty too is such a transcendental, which is one way of explaining the point already made, that beauty belongs to every category. He also thought that beauty and goodness are, in the end, identical, being separate ways in which a single positive reality is rationally apprehended. If that is so, however, what is ugliness, and why do we flee from it? And how can there be dangerous beauties, corrupting beauties, and immoral beauties? And if such things are impossible, why are they impossible? And what is it that misleads us into thinking the opposite? I don't say that Aquinas has no answer to those questions, but they illustrate the difficulties encountered by any philosophy that places beauty on the same metaphysical plane as truth, so as to plant it in the heart of being as such. The natural response is to say that beauty is a matter of appearance, not of being, and perhaps also that in exploring beauty we are investigating the sentiments of people rather than the deep structure of the world. Some platitudes. That said, we should take a lesson from the philosophy of truth. Attempts to define truth, to tell us what truth deeply and essentially is, have seldom carried conviction, since they always end by presupposing what they need to prove. How can you define truth without already assuming the distinction between a true definition and a false one? Wrestling with this problem, philosophers have suggested that a theory of truth must conform to certain logical platitudes, and that these platitudes, innocuous though they may seem to the untheoretical eye, provide the ultimate test of any philosophical theory. For example, there is the platitude that if a sentence S is true, so is the sentence S is true, and vice versa. There are the platitudes that one truth cannot contradict another, that assertions claim to be true, that our assertions are not true simply because we say so. Philosophers say profound-seeming things about truth, but often the air of profundity comes at the cost of denying one or other of those elementary platitudes. It would help to define our subject, therefore, if we were to begin from a list of comparable platitudes about beauty, against which our theories might be tested. Here are six of them. 1. Beauty pleases us. 2. One thing can be more beautiful than another. 3. Beauty is always a reason for attending to the thing that possesses it. 4. Beauty is the subject matter of a judgment, the judgment of taste. 5. The judgment of taste is about the beautiful object, not about the subject's state of mind. In describing an object as beautiful, I am describing it, not me. 6. Nevertheless, there are no second-hand judgments of beauty. There is no way that you can argue me into a judgment that I have not made for myself, nor can I become an expert in beauty simply by studying what others have said about beautiful objects, and without experiencing and judging for myself. This last platitude may be doubted. I might swear by a certain music critic whose judgments of pieces and performances I take as gospel. Isn't that like adopting my scientific beliefs from the opinions of experts, or my legal beliefs from the judgments of the courts? The answer is no. When I put my trust in a critic, this is tantamount to saying that I defer to his judgment, even when I have made no judgment of my own. But my own judgment waits upon experience. It is only when I have heard the piece in question, in the moment of appreciation, that my borrowed opinion can actually become a judgment of mine. Hence the comedy of this dialogue from Jane Austen's Emma. "Mr. Dixon, you say, is not strictly speaking handsome?" "Handsome? Oh no, far from it. Certainly plain. I told you he was plain." "My dear, you said that Miss Campbell would not allow him to be plain, and that you yourself..." "Oh, as for me, my judgment is worth nothing. Where I have a great regard, I always think a person well-looking, but I have what I believed the general opinion when I called him plain." In this dialogue, the second speaker, Jane Fairfax, is ignoring her experience of Mr. Dixon's looks, so that in describing him as plain, she is not making a judgment of her own, but reporting the judgment of others. A paradox. The first three of those platitudes apply to the attractive and the enjoyable. If something is enjoyable, then that is a reason for taking an interest in it, and some things are more enjoyable than others. There is also a sense in which you cannot judge something to be enjoyable at second hand. Your own enjoyable is the criterion of sincerity. And when reporting on some object that others find enjoyable, the best you can sincerely say is that it is apparently enjoyable, or that it seems to be enjoyable, since others find it so. However, it is not at all clear that the judgment that something is enjoyable is about it, rather than the nature and character of people. Certainly, we judge between enjoyable things. It is right to enjoy some things, wrong to enjoy others. But these judgments focus on the state of mind of the subject, rather than a quality in the object. We can say all that we want to say about the rightness and wrongness of our enjoyments without invoking the idea that some things are really enjoyable, others only apparently so. With beauty, matters are otherwise. Here the judgment focuses on the object judged, not on the subject who judges. We distinguish true beauty from fake beauty, from kitsch, schmaltz, and whimsy. We argue about beauty and strive to educate our taste, and our judgments of beauty are often supported by critical reasoning, which focuses entirely on the character of the object. All these points seem obvious, and yet, when combined with the other platitudes that I have identified, they generate a paradox which threatens to undermine the entire subject of aesthetics. The judgment of taste is a genuine judgment, one that is supported by reasons, but these reasons can never amount to a deductive argument. If they could do so, then there could be second-hand opinions about beauty. There could be experts on beauty who had never experienced the things they describe, and rules for producing beauty which could be applied by someone who had no aesthetic tastes. It is true that artists often attempt to invoke beauties other than those they create. Wordsworth invokes the beauty of the Lakeland landscape, Proust the beauty of a sonata of Vinteuil, Mann the beauty of Joseph and Homer, the beauty of Helen of Troy. But the beauty that we perceive in these invocations resides in them, not in the things described. It is possible that a bust of Helen might one day be dug from the soil of Troy and authenticated as a true likeness, even though you and I are struck by the ugliness of the woman depicted and appalled to think of a war being fought for so charmless a cause. I have been half in love with the woman portrayed in Janáček's second quartet and half in love with the one immortalized in Tristan und Isolde. Those works bear unimpeachable witness to the beauty that inspired them. Yet, to my chagrin, photographs of Kamila Stoslova and Mathilde Wiesendonck show a pair of ungainly frumps. The paradox, then, is this. The judgment of beauty makes a claim about its object and can be supported by reasons for its claim, but the reasons do not compel the judgment and can be rejected without contradiction. So are they reasons or aren't they? Minimal beauty. Here it is important to make room for our second platitude. Things can often be compared and ranked according to their beauty, and there is also a minimal beauty, beauty in the lowest degree, which might be a long way from the sacred beauties of art and nature which are discussed by the philosophers. There is an aesthetic minimalism exemplified by laying the table, tidying your room, designing a website, which seems at first sight quite remote from the aesthetic heroism exemplified by Bernini's St. Teresa in Ecstasy, or Bach's Well-Tempered Clavier. You don't wrestle over these things as Beethoven wrestled over the late quartets, nor do you expect them to be recorded for all time among the triumphs of artistic achievement. Nevertheless, you want the table, the room, or the website to look right, and looking right matters in the way that beauty generally matters. Not by pleasing the eye only, but by conveying meanings and values which have weight for you, and which you are consciously putting on display. This platitude is of great importance in understanding architecture. Venice would be less beautiful without the great buildings that grace the waterfronts, Longhena's Church of Santa Maria della Salute, the Cardoro, the Ducal Palace. But these buildings are set among modest neighbours, which neither compete with nor spoil them. Neighbours whose principal virtue resides precisely in their neighbourliness, their refusal to draw attention to themselves or to claim the exalted status of high art. Ravishing beauties are less important in the aesthetics of architecture than things that fit appropriately together, creating a soothing and harmonious context, a continuous narrative, as in a street or a square, where nothing stands out in particular and good manners prevail. Much that is said about beauty and its importance in our lives ignores the minimal beauty of an unpretentious street, a nice pair of shoes, or a tasteful piece of wrapping paper, as though these things belong to a different order of value from a church by Bramante or a Shakespeare sonnet. Yet these minimal beauties are far more important to our daily lives and far more intricately involved in our own rational decisions than the great works which, if we are lucky, occupy our leisure hours. They are part of the context in which we live our lives, and our desire for harmony, fittingness, and civility is both expressed and confirmed in them. Moreover, the great works of architecture often depend for their beauty on the humble context that these lesser beauties provide. Longena's church on the Grand Canal would lose its confident and invocatory presence, were the modest buildings which nestle in its shadow to be replaced with cast concrete office blocks, of the kind that ruin the aspect of St. Paul's. Some consequences. Our second platitude is not without consequences. We need to take seriously the suggestion that judgments of value tend to be comparative. When we judge things in respect of their goodness and beauty, our concern is very often to rank alternatives with a view to choosing between them. The pursuit of absolute or ideal beauty may distract us from the more urgent business of getting things right. It is well and good for philosophers, poets, and theologians to point towards beauty in its highest form, but for most of us, it is far more important to achieve order in the things surrounding us and to ensure that the eyes, the ears, and the sense of fittingness are not repeatedly offended. Another consideration follows, which is that the emphasis on beauty might, in certain cases, be self-defeating, by implying that our choices are between different degrees of a single quality, so that we must always aim for what is most beautiful in everything that we choose. In fact, too much attention to beauty might defeat its own object. In the case of urban design, for example, the goal is, in the first instance, to fit in, not to stand out. If you want to stand out, then you have to be worthy of the attention that you claim, like Longena's church. This does not mean that the humble and harmonious street is not beautiful. Rather, it suggests that we can understand its beauty better if we describe it in another and less loaded way, as a form of fittingness or harmony. Were we to aim in every case at the kind of supreme beauty exemplified by Santa Maria della Salute, we should end with aesthetic overload. The clamorous masterpieces, jostling for attention side by side, would lose their distinctiveness, and the beauty of each of them would be at war with the beauty of the rest. This point leads to another, which is that beautiful is by no means the only adjective that we deploy in making judgments of this kind. We praise things for their elegance, their intricacy, their fine patina. We admire music for its expressiveness, its discipline, its orderliness. We appreciate the pretty, the charming, and the attractive, and we will often be far more confident in such judgments than in an unqualified assertion that a thing is beautiful. To speak of beauty is to enter another and more exalted realm, a realm sufficiently apart from our everyday concerns as to be mentioned with only a certain hesitation. People who are always in praise and pursuit of the beautiful are an embarrassment, like people who make a constant display of their religious faith. Somehow we feel such things should be kept for our exalted moments and not paraded in company or allowed to spill out over dinner. Of course, we might agree that to be pretty, expressive, elegant, or whatever is to be to that extent beautiful, but only to that extent, and not to the extent that Plato, Plotinus, or Walter Pater would have us go, by way of declaring our aesthetic commitments. In making this qualified admission, we would be pleading for the aesthetic common sense. But common sense also points to the fluidity of our language. She is very pretty. Yes, beautiful, is a cogent statement. But so too is, she is very pretty, but hardly beautiful. Delight is more important than the terms used to express it, and the terms themselves are in a certain measure anchorless, used more to suggest an effect than to pinpoint the qualities that give rise to it. Two concepts of beauty. The judgment of beauty, it emerges, is not merely a statement of preference. It demands an act of attention, and it may be expressed in many different ways. Less important than the final verdict is the attempt to show what is right, fitting, worthwhile, attractive, or expressive in the object. In other words, to identify the aspect of the thing that claims our attention. The word beauty may very well not figure in our attempts to articulate and to harmonize our tastes, and this suggests a distinction between the judgment of beauty considered as a justification of taste and the emphasis on beauty as a distinctive way of appealing to that judgment. There is no contradiction in saying that Bartok's score for The Miraculous Mandarin is harsh, rebarbative, even ugly, and at the same time praising the work as one of the triumphs of early modern music. Its aesthetic virtues are of a different order from those of Fauré's Pavane, which aims only to be exquisitely beautiful and succeeds. Another way of putting the point is to distinguish two concepts of beauty. In one sense, beauty means aesthetic success. In another sense, it means only a certain kind of aesthetic success. There are works of art which we regard as set apart by their pure beauty, works that take our breath away, like Botticelli's Birth of Venus, Keats' Ode to a Nightingale, or Susanna's aria in the garden in Mozart's Marriage of Figaro. Such works are sometimes described as ravishing, meaning that they demand wonder and reverence and fill us with an untroubled and consoling delight. And because words, in the context of aesthetic judgment, are loose and slippery, we often reserve the term beautiful for works of this kind, meaning to lay special emphasis on their kind of enrapturing appeal. Likewise, with landscapes and people we encounter, the pure and breathtaking examples which render us speechless, content merely to bathe in their glow. And we praise such things for their sheer beauty, implying that should we attempt to analyze their effect on us, words would fail. We might even go so far as to say of certain works of art that they are too beautiful, that they ravish when they should disturb, or provide dreamy intoxication when what is needed is a gesture of harsh despair. This could be said, I think, of Tennyson's In Memoriam, and maybe of Fauré's Requiem too, even though both are, in their ways, supreme artistic achievements. All this suggests that we should be wary of paying too much attention to words, even to the word that defines the subject matter of this book. What matters first and foremost is a certain kind of judgment, for which the technical term aesthetic is now in common use. The suggestion that there might be a supreme aesthetic value for which the term beauty should be more properly reserved is one that we must bear in mind. For the moment, however, it is more important to understand beauty in its general sense as the subject matter of aesthetic judgment.
Means, ends, and contemplation. There is a widespread view, which is less a platitude than a first shot at a theory, which distinguishes the interest in beauty from the interest in getting things done. We appreciate beautiful things, not for their utility only, but also for what they are in themselves, or more plausibly, for how they appear in themselves. With the good, the true, and the useful, wrote Schiller, man is merely in earnest, but with the beautiful he plays. When our interest is entirely taken up by a thing, as it appears in our perception, and independently of any use to which it might be put, then do we begin to speak of its beauty. The thought here gave rise in the 18th century to an important distinction between the fine and the useful arts. Useful arts like architecture, carpet weaving, and carpentry have a function and can be judged according to how well they fulfill it. But a functional building or carpet is not for that reason beautiful. In referring to architecture as a useful art, we are emphasizing another aspect of it, the aspect that lies beyond utility. we are implying that a work of architecture can be appreciated not only as a means to some goal, but also as an end in itself, as a thing intrinsically meaningful. In wrestling with the distinction between the fine and useful arts, les beaux-arts et l'art utile, Enlightenment thinkers made the first steps towards our modern conception of the work of art as a thing whose value resides in it and not in its purpose. All art is quite useless, wrote Oscar Wilde, not wishing to deny, however, that art has very powerful effects, his own drama of Salome being one lurid instance. That said, we should recognize that the distinction between aesthetic and utilitarian interests is no more clear than the language used to define it. What exactly is meant by those who say we are interested in a work of art for its own sake, on account of its intrinsic value, as an end in itself? These terms are philosophical technicalities, which indicate no clear contrast between aesthetic interest and the utilitarian approach that is imposed on us by the needs of everyday decision-making. Other epochs did not recognize the distinction that we now so frequently make between art and craft. Our word poetry comes from Greek poiasis, the skill of making things. The Roman artes comprised every kind of practical endeavor. And to take our second platitude about beauty seriously is to be skeptical towards the whole idea of the beautiful as a realm apart, untainted by mundane practicalities. Maybe we shouldn't be too troubled by that commonsensical skepticism, however. Even if it is not yet clear what is meant by intrinsic value, we have no difficulty in understanding someone who says of a picture or a piece of music that appeals to him, that he could look at it or listen to it forever, and that it has for him no other purpose than itself. Wanting the individual. Suppose Rachel points to a peach in a bowl and says, "I want that peach." And suppose you hand her another peach from the same bowl and she responds, "No, it is that peach I wanted." You would be puzzled by this. Surely any ripe peach would do just as well, if the purpose is to eat it. "But that's just it," she says. "I don't want to eat it. I want it, that particular peach. No other peach will do." What is it that attracts Rachel to this peach? What explains her claim that it is just this peach and no other that she wants? One thing that would explain this state of mind is the judgment of beauty. "I want that peach because it is so beautiful." Wanting something for its beauty is wanting it, not wanting to do something with it, nor having obtained the peach, held it, turned it around, studied it from every angle, would it be open to Rachel to say, "Good, that's it, I'm satisfied." If she had wanted it for its beauty, then there is no point at which her desire could be satisfied, nor is there any action, process, or whatever, following which the desire is over and done with. She can want to inspect the peach for all sorts of reasons, even for no reason at all. But wanting it for its beauty is not wanting to inspect it. It is wanting to contemplate it, and that is something more than a search for information or an expression of appetite. Here is a want without a goal, a desire that cannot be fulfilled since there is nothing that would count as its fulfillment. Suppose someone now offers Rachel another peach from the bowl, saying, "Take this, it will do just as well." Would this not show a failure to understand her motive? She is interested in this, the particular fruit that she finds so beautiful. No substitute can satisfy her interest, since it is an interest in the individual thing, as the thing that it is. If Rachel wants the fruit for some further purpose, to eat it, say, or to throw it at the man who is bothering her, then some other object might have served her purpose. In such a case, her desire is not for the individual peach, but for any member of a functionally equivalent class. The example resembles one given by Wittgenstein in his Lectures on Aesthetics. I sit down to listen to a Mozart quartet. My friend, Rachel, enters the room, takes out the disc and replaces it with another, say a quartet by Haydn, saying, "Try this, it will do just as well." Rachel has shown that she does not understand my state of mind. There is no way in which my interest in the Mozart could be satisfied by the Haydn, although, of course, it can be eclipsed by it. The point here is not easy to state exactly. I might have chosen the Mozart as therapy, knowing that it had always helped me to relax. The Haydn might be every bit as therapeutic, and in that sense an appropriate substitute for the Mozart. But then, it is a substitute as therapy and not as music. In that sense, I could have substituted a warm bath for the Mozart or a ride out on my horse, equally effective therapies for tension. But the Haydn cannot satisfy my interest in the Mozart for the simple reason that my interest in the Mozart is an interest in it, for the particular thing that it is, and not for any purpose that it serves. A caveat. There is a danger involved in taking the 18th century distinction between the fine and the useful arts too seriously. On one reading, it might seem to imply that the utility of something, a building, a tool, a car, must be entirely discounted in any judgment of its beauty. To experience beauty, it might seem to imply, we should concentrate on pure form, detached from utility. But this ignores the fact that knowledge of function is a vital preliminary to the experience of form.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.